getting them. If you would take a songbook and turn to number 851, Don Duke Manier is going to be leading us in that song in just a moment. Following that song, we'll have a prayer by Brother Pat Bradford, and then we'll turn the floor over to Brother Jody Apple. Although Brother Jody Apple's talked to us about the International Bible Hour and his involvement with that, and he's going to sort of just touch on what he's doing a little bit as he gets started tonight to give us a better appreciation for all that's going on. But he just started full-time April 1st, which I wasn't aware of, but I didn't know the involvement, and we've talked about that with him for last couple of years, some of the him phasing into that. So he's full-time into that now as of April 1st, and he's going to talk to us about that. We're appreciative for him being here tonight. He has lessons that are very interesting, and of course we've heard him speak on two or three occasions here, so we're certainly look forward to what he has to say to us tonight. Once we have our song and our prayer, then we'll turn it over to him, and he'll present the lesson for the evening.
Somebody said I should do this one, and it's a puppet song, so it works for me. Let's sing the first and third verses. Blue skies and
rainbows and sunbeams from heaven are what I can see when my Lord is in me. I know that Jesus is well and alive today. He makes his home in my heart. Nevermore will I be all alone since he promised me that we never would part. All mountains, green valleys, the beauty that surrounds me all make me aware of the one who made it all. I know that Jesus is well and alive today. He makes his home in my heart.
Let us pray. Father, we come before you tonight thanking you for all the blessings that you give us, for the blessings in this good day and being able to go about our work in this world, to be able to know that you are near with us at all times. Father, we thank you for this time together tonight as a family of Christians, that we may join our voices together and lift each other up, that we may together lift our voices to you, both in praise and in supplication. Father, open our hearts tonight, that we may be attentive to the words that are presented to us, that we may listen and learn to be better servants of yours. Keep us always in your care, Father. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good evening. I'd like to get a couple of volunteers to help me pass out some handouts. There's no financial reward, but you'll feel good. And while they're doing that, let me encourage you to turn in your Bibles to the book of Matthew, chapter 11. The verses that we're going to key in on are the last three verses in the passage, Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 and following. Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 and following. Our lesson entitled Jesus Taught Comfort is what we're going to address in just a few moments. While the material is being passed out that we're going to cover as part of our lesson, Let me just take a moment or two to talk a little bit about International Gospel Hour. I brought a stack of cards for those. If you'd like to pick one of those up later, I'll leave some in the back, or you can pick one up for me as you're exiting this evening. The International Gospel Hour started in 1934, and in 1934, radio was relatively new. It had only been around about 10 to 12 years. And for the first 80 years of its existence, only two speakers were part of that work, V.E. Howard, the brother that started it, and Winfred Claiborne. Winfred Claiborne passed away last year, November 18th. So we continue to run some of his programs through the end of the year. I started doing all the long programs at the beginning of the year while I was still teaching part-time at Southeast Institute of Biblical Studies. That was formerly known as East Tennessee School of Preaching and Missions. And as of the 1st of April, I dropped back to teaching one class a quarter and am devoting full-time to International Gospel Hour. I don't want to give you an entire lesson about things that have taken place in the last few months, but let me just hit the highlights of a couple of things. One of the things that's been changed is that we're lengthening the amount of time that we're preaching in each broadcast, and we're also doing something a little bit different. In a class like this, or especially in our worship services, most of the information that is disseminated goes one direction, from me going out to you, especially during our worship services, that's the case. And that's the way we've done the radio for a long time. There's a person speaking, recording things, and it's disseminated by means of AM and FM stations, as well as the internet, all around the country and all around the world. And one of the things that I asked the elders at Fayetteville for permission to do was to incorporate more responsivity on the part of those people who are listening to the broadcast. And so if you go to internationalgospelhour.com and you follow the media tab, and go down to audio, you can listen to all of our long programs since the beginning of the year. Next Sunday's program is already up there, for example. And once you start listening at the beginning of the year and then listen for a couple of months or so to those weekly broadcasts and notice some changes. First thing is we've cut back on some of the music that we use. There's nothing wrong with a cappella music, obviously, but we use that only as an introduction for a few seconds at the beginning and as a trailer at the end. And one of the things that's very unique is that since beginning of February, gospel preachers from all around the country now introduce the program. And so Glenn Colley, for example, that works with the West Huntsville Church, I'm picking on him because he's local, we'll get Tim to do one, introduced one of the programs not too long ago. And after he said, "Hi, you're about to listen to the International Gospel Hour with my good friend Jody Apple," when he does that, then I come on, I'll say, "Hey, thanks Glenn for doing that," and I'll give a plug for the congregation at West Huntsville. So we're doing that all over the place. Here's what I want people who are listening to the broadcast to think. There are churches of Christ all around the country, and indeed there are. So we're using that as a means of promoting the work. Additionally, one of the things that we do in the context of our programs is we stop occasionally in the midst of the broadcast and offer something for free to people who are listening. If you listen to religious radio on a general radio station or television station, most of those folks stop and do commercials in which they sell something or they ask you to make a donation to their work. Well, we don't do that. And so we will pause and say, before we continue the broadcast, let me remind you that we have a free 30-lesson correspondence course that you can get. All you have to do is call us at 1-855-IGH-6988. I'll repeat the number two or three times in the course of 30 to 45 seconds. We do that multiple times per program. What is it doing? Well, it's prompting people to call. Now, if this works, I'm going to let you listen to a little bit of a call that just came in this past week from somebody. I think this lady listened to the station in New Orleans. When somebody calls, I get a voicemail and an email that shows up, and it tells me somebody just called and left you a message. And it gives me a rough transcription of the person's name, address, and so forth. There may be a couple of errors, but it also sends me an MP3 file. So when I tap on the MP3 file, it opens up in my browser, and this is what I get.
Rebecca Espadrill. E, S as in Sam, P as in Tom.
Now, I'm not going to play the whole thing, but Rebecca spelled her last name because it's a difficult name, and then she told me she listens on 105.3. That comes out of New Orleans on Sunday night at 9 o'clock on Central. That station is a clear channel, 50,000-watt stations. I've been driving back from a trip to New York City and then visiting a congregation in West Virginia to help support our work. And I listen to it 720 miles away from New Orleans because it's a very powerful station. And so we have had about 150 calls and contacts from the things that we've been doing just in the last few months since we've made our programs that much more responsive. We are hoping that once this model is perfected, we'll be able to ramp it up and increase our number of broadcasts all around the country and even around the world. We have an opportunity to preach in English in Africa every day and six times a day on their websites on shortwave radio stations for less than it costs that station that appears that you just heard this lady call in response to, from New Orleans and WWL. So keep our work in your prayers. If you want to pick up one of the cards later, you're certainly welcome to do so. If you have a smartphone, you're not going to hurt my feelings if you go to internationalgospelhour.com while I'm speaking and you click through to our Facebook page and sign up to get our newsletters and so forth. We have over 2,000 people that are following us there. Some of those are members of the church. Some of those are not members of the church. Some of those are even denominational pastors that are following us because I've engaged in some conversations with them. So if you want to know more about the work, just let me know and we'll go forward from there. So again, that's internationalgospelhour.com. If you want a card, make sure you pick one up before you leave this evening. Let me encourage you to look at that passage in Matthew chapter 11. Verses 28 and following. Did everybody get a handout? Everybody got a handout? Okay, good. Well, I'm not going to read through that word for word. That's primarily to keep me on track. But if you want to read through this and gain additional information of the material that we won't be able to cover because of time, you are certainly free to do that when we are done. The last three verses, let me just read them. Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." This is a very unique invitation that's presented in the context of Matthew's gospel. It's not the only one by any means, it's one of many. And what I want to do is take some time this evening to explore that. If you look at the top of the page, I've broken those three verses down into eight bite-sized chunks that we want to analyze. And here's how I'm summing them up. So if you follow with me at the beginning of the page, you'll see what it is that we're going to do exactly. There's an invitation. Jesus says, "Come to me." There's an appeal. I designate it as a universal appeal. When Jesus said, not just come to me, but come to me all you who labor and are heavy laden. There's a promise. And I identify it as the first promise because, as you'll see as we go through this, there's more than one promise cited in these three verses. The first promise is, I will give you rest. But in addition to Jesus' invitation that is made universally, in which there's a promise extended on the other end of that invitation, Jesus indicates that there's a condition, a responsibility that he expects of those people who are listening to him on this occasion to fulfill. And that is this, take my yoke upon you. Immediately followed by what I'm identifying as a second condition or responsibility, and that is not just take my yoke upon you, but learn from me. Exactly what is it that Jesus wants them to learn? In part, in this quick summation of invitation here, he wants them to know about who he is and what he's like, the nature of the Christ, summed up in the expression, "I am gentle and lowly in hearts." And then he says a second promise, similar to the one that we noticed before. First, he says, "I will give you rest." He amplifies it, just a little bit more explanation here. He says, "You will find rest for your souls." And then he closes with this expression, "For my yoke is easy and my burden is light," that is a repetition of a condition, the yoke part of it, a repetition of the promise because it is easy and the burden is light, and the nature of Christ combined, that is his gentleness that's exposed and expressed earlier about being gentle and lowly in heart, is brought out from the standpoint of the responsibility that we're going to share in taking up his burden. It's an easy burden. That doesn't mean there's no work involved. I'm going to explain that. And it also says in this context that it is light. So here are the eight general principles that I want us to go through in the course of our lesson this evening in order to emphasize this singular point. Our title is Jesus Taught Comfort. Jesus Taught Comfort. Now, I suspect that all of us have a favorite place to sit in our homes. It's our chair. It's our spot. May even have a favorite chair here. I'm not sure. But they all look alike to me, so I'm not sure if any one pew is more comfortable than another. But there's a place where I like to sit. in my house, and it happens to be a large recliner, and it's not because it's large, it's because it's comfortable, but the other thing is my dogs like to crawl up on my lap when I get in there. So it's not just my spot, it's a spot where the big dog, it's a lab mix, it's about 75 pounds, is on the right side, and the little dog's about 26 pounds, gets on the right, on the left side, and then I still have room for my laptop in the middle. So my kids get a big kick when I send pictures through text messaging. I said, here's what Dad's doing this evening. They can see the laptop. They can see a dog on the left and right, and I'm comfortable. I can work. I can get a lot of stuff done. When the dogs need attention, I can reach down and scratch heads on both sides, no problem whatsoever. And that's comfortable to me. I like that position. Well, when we're thinking about comfort, spiritually speaking, we're not talking about an easy chair. We're not talking about a recliner. We're not talking about something that's cushy. We're not talking about something that makes us feel good physically, but it is comfort of a different nature. Christ wants to provide for us a comfort that's going to the level of our soul, not to the level of our seats. And that's what I want us to address as we're speaking this evening. So let's work our way through this. The first major section of the eight is the invitation in which Jesus says, "Come to me." Now, there's a passage earlier in the book of Matthew in which Jesus called the apostles to him, and we see the beginning of that chain of calling of the apostles, Peter and Andrew and James and John, two sets of brothers and so forth, when he said, "Come follow after me." Well, Jesus gives an invitation in this context, but it's different. It's almost the same words in one sense, but he couches it in slightly different language in order to make it more compelling, more imperative, that much more of a command. There are a number of passages in the New Testament that we assume to be invitations that are not universal invitations. The passage, for example, in the book of Revelation chapter 3, where it says, "I stand at the door and knock," is not one given to the world as a whole, but given to those faithful members of the church who are struggling with their faithfulness, not to give up on that faithfulness. Same sort of thing in the book of Revelation in the 22nd chapter, in the 18th verse, when it says, "The Spirit and the Bride say, come." When you look at that out of context, the assumption is that's a universal invitation to all people to become Christ. Don't get me wrong, those appear frequently in the biblical text. But in those particular settings, they're referring to Christians who are struggling with temptation, struggling with trials and tribulations, and who are thinking about moving away from the Christ because the temptations have become so severe. So in that context, Jesus is inviting them to continue to be faithful. That's not what we have going on in this context. Jesus is inviting people to come to him. But it's not just saying, "Come, follow me." Jesus is emphatically saying, "Come, come to me." And it's an imperative tense that's used. And so Jesus is not just saying, "Okay, if you want, come follow after me. Like I'm going to go on a hike," something like that. There was much more dignity involved, obviously, when he was calling the apostles. But they didn't fully understand what was going on. Yes, he was going to make them fishers of men. But in this particular occasion, the emphatic nature of Jesus' invitation is such that I want you to come, and I want you to come to me, directly to me. And so in the sense that we are coming to Jesus and he's front and center when we come to him, we are facing him. And you're going to see that Jesus is not only addressing this physically from the standpoint of us coming to him, but that he is spiritually the center of everything that's going to be addressed in this passage. And so this invitation is very Christ-centered, obviously, as we're going to go through it. So this is an imperative. It's something in which he is demanding them to come to him directly. Now notice the second point. There's an appeal that's made, and it's a universal appeal, couched in the language of saying this, "All who are labor and are heavy laden." Now again, in the context, he's not talking about physical labor, and he's not talking about being physically burdened. Just like when he says, when we come to him, he doesn't just mean appearing before him in his physical presence. That same invitation applies to us today, but obviously Jesus isn't here physically today. And that's something that I want us to understand as we're going through this. We sometimes have a disconnect between what we read in the biblical text and its application in our own lives. And there's a reason why. We're reading about people and places and events and principles and practices that were employed 2,000 years ago by people whose names we know, but whom we really don't know. And what we need to do is to be able to connect with them as much as we possibly can. in order to understand that the principles and practices of faith that were enjoined upon them 2,000 years ago have equal application today. And so when Jesus says, come to me, he doesn't just mean physically come, in the sense that he told the apostles before in Matthew 4, come follow after me. He means come before me, confront me, find out who I am. Let me tell you all about me so that you can become followers of mine. And so when he says, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, he's not talking about physical work. And my daughter became a nurse in the course of the last year. She works at Piedmont Hospital System in Atlanta. And she recently worked 5 straight 12-hour shifts every day for 5 days. She'd never done that before. Well, 60 hours in 5 days, that's a lot. Sometimes people work 7 12-hour shifts in a week, and even longer than that. But he's not saying, I want you to come to me if you're tired of working long shifts, wherever it is that you work, in a plant or an office, whatever it is that you might be doing. He's not trying to get people to come to him because they're exhausted physically. The labor and the burden that's addressing in the general context of the New Testament is, one, the burden of sin, but specifically in the context of the book of Matthew, the burden that the law of Moses would have placed upon the children of Israel. On occasion, Peter said, with reference to that law in Acts chapter 15, that it was a yoke which neither you nor your fathers were able to bear. The law was a burden. It was something that was weighty. It was something that brought them down. It was something that did not accomplish ultimately what God wanted to accomplish, and that's freedom from sin through Christ. That's what Jesus addressed in John chapter 8. And so Jesus is saying, I want you to come. I want you to come to me. That's imperative. I want you who are laboring under the weight of sin to come to me. Now, you might say, well, to whom does that apply? Well, ultimately, it applies to everybody. But not everybody recognizes what sin is, and not everybody understands the consequences of sin equally, and not everybody identifies things as sin the way God does. Now, my job as a Christian, not as a preacher, not as a teacher, is to make sure I see what God wants me to know from the standpoint of the identification of sin and my admission of my own sin and my responsibility to God from the standpoint of what needs to be done in order to repudiate and to repent of that sin. Now, that applies to every individual. And so I don't get to define sin. I don't get to choose the responses that God wants me to demonstrate with reference to sin. That's already been determined. And so inherent in this passage already is a sense in which when Jesus calls people to him, there's an aspect of submission that's inherent in these expressions. Now, a couple of days ago, the two lovely dogs that like to sit on my laps, my wife and I took them to obedience school. Got a young lady in the congregation who's going to UT, and one of the things that she's majoring in is animal husbandry, and she's doing classes on Monday nights teaching people how to get their disobedient dogs to be obedient to them. And one of the things that we were training these dogs to do, now one of them is almost 10 years old, the smaller one, but the other one that's all lab is 3 years old, and she's got more spunk than she needs to have. And one of the things that we're to train them to do is to heel and to follow us. But another thing is to get them, once they stay, is to be able to walk away from them, turn and face them with them not moving, and have them come on command. And come on command so that they come and sit immediately in front of you and look straight at you. That's what Jesus wants us to do. We're not dogs, though. We're not dogs. And we can train dogs to do that by means of repetition, by means of command, and by means of giving them little tidbits to encourage them to see what they're doing. Jesus wants us to do this not looking for little tidbits. And Jesus wants us to do this because we come to love him in the context of our submission to him. And so first we see an invitation. And we see that's an invitation that's based universally to all people who labor under the weight of sin, the sin that does so easily beset us, is the way it's identified in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 and following, and also those who are being weighed down by the burdens of the Old Testament law. Notice the first promise, the next expression. Jesus said, I will give you rest. Let's focus on the I part of it first. Jesus is emphatic in saying that you need to come and you need to come directly before me. And you need to realize that I can give you this rest that we're talking about, but nobody else can. In effect, Jesus is saying, I and I alone can provide this for you. It's what we see in other passages that are similar from the standpoint of their import. John chapter 14, verse 6. No man can come to the Father except through Christ. Well, what if you want to go into another way? Well, there is no other way. John chapter 10 says anybody who tries to go into the sheepfold by means of another door, the same as a thief and a robber. There's a singular way. And so Jesus is the one through whom we must come. And so when Jesus says, I can give you rest, he's not competing with somebody else who can give legitimate rest. Nobody else can do what he's offering. The rest that he's offering in this context is something that solely comes through Christ. That's part of the divine plan. Now, this is part of an overall principle and pattern of singularity or oneness that's taught everywhere in scriptures. You know, of course, the passage in Ephesians chapter 4. One Lord, one God, one Spirit, one faith, one hope, one body, one baptism. Not presented in that order. They're all about principles of oneness. And Jesus often speaks about principles of oneness. And that's because the Father did before. In the Old Testament book of Deuteronomy, he says, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And Jesus repeats that as foundational to the Ten Commandments in Mark chapter 12 when he's asked about the great commandments. Even before he says, Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind, and love your neighbors yourself, he says, Hear this first, the Lord is one. And flowing from the oneness of God in Deuteronomy chapter 6, there's one God, one world, brought out in Deuteronomy 4 and Deuteronomy chapter 30. There's one way, one word that he has revealed. There's one way that we live in order to be his, and that all contributes to a singular people. So watch all of these singular principles. One God, one world, one word, one way that creates one people. And Jesus knows that he's part of that one way that people are supposed to live. Nobody can come to the Father except by means of him. And so when Jesus says, I will give you rest, he's simply saying, nobody else can do what I alone can do. Now that is not because Jesus is egomaniacal. It's not because that he has usurped divine authority. It's because he is equal to God in all respects. He's the character of God, Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 and following. He is the express image of his glory that we see in that passage. He is made of the same essence that God is in Philippians chapter 2. He was with God in the beginning because he was God. And so all of these passages demonstrate that Jesus is on par with God. The only way that this rest is going to come to you is because Jesus himself can give it. Now, the rest that's under consideration is a qualified rest. Again, it's not going to a comfortable, easy chair. The rest that all of us observe in the course of our physical lives is temporary and it's partial. If you work 5 12-hour days in a row, you may get off a day or two, but guess what? You're going back to work. You don't get to rest forever from your labors in this life. It's always temporary and it's always partial. But in the context of what Jesus is addressing, he's talking about a rest that transcends physical resting and relaxation. He's talking about a rest that's not temporary, but that's permanent. He's not talking about a rest that's partial, but that one is complete. And that hope and that prospect of a rest beyond this physical life is one that's held out everywhere in the biblical text. God, through Moses, referred to Canaan as a land of rest. Does that mean they didn't do any work? No. They had to plant gardens, even though many were already planted. They had to drive out the inhabitants and so forth. God was going to give it to them, but they still had to work. But yet it was still designated as a land of rest. One day, when all of those things were finalized and their enemies were driven out, if they'd done so completely, God says, and I will give you rest round about from all your enemies. Something we see repeatedly emphasized. But the land of Canaan was a symbol and a type of something even greater. The Hebrews writer uses that expression that says, there yet remains a rest for the people of God. Not another physical land of Canaan. Not a land in which we have to go in and we have to drive the inhabitants out of it so that we could own that land, a land flowing with milk and honey. But in that context, he's talking about a spiritual land of Canaan that's greater than the physical land of Canaan. And that's all over the book of Hebrews, in which there's a comparison of something lesser, though great in and of itself, a rest in the land of Canaan. that exists in anticipation of an even greater rest, a greater land of Canaan. And that, of course, is talking about our heavenly home. And so Jesus said, come to me. You have to come and face me. Everybody who labors, that applies to everyone who labors under the weight of sin. And he says, I will give you rest. Now let's drop down to the fourth point. The first condition and the first responsibility. Jesus says, take my yoke upon you. Now, it might be somewhat of a paradox to use the word rest in the same context in which the word yoke is used. Because traditionally the word yoke means there's some degree of oppression that's going on here, and that makes me uncomfortable. I don't want to be yoked to anybody or anything. I want my freedom. Well, I understand that. There is a sense in which the term yoke in both the Old Testament Hebrew Scriptures and in the New Testament can be used in an oppressive way, but it's not always used that way. There are some senses in which it can be used in a positive sense. One of those is brought out in the book of Jeremiah, Lamentation, cited there, in which it talks about us being yoked or joined together with God. That's not at all intended to be anything that's negative or has negative consequences. Now, there's some other things I want you to think about. If you're going to have to haul some sort of burden, I would rather have a yoke or a harness of some kind attached to a rope rather than pulling directly on the rope. Well, the rope is rather narrow. It doesn't distribute the pain and the weight evenly and so forth, and it's going to hurt. And so there's a concept in which a yoke is a useful tool in order to accomplish the distribution of a weight or a burden that's going to be borne. So that's something that to think about. Notice also that Jesus identifies this yoke as my yoke. And there's a couple of senses in which that might be the case. It's a yoke that Christ places upon us, yes, but it's also a sense in which there's a yoke that Christ places upon us in which he himself is a yoke bearer with us, helping us bear burdens. And that's a principle we see in 1 Peter chapter 5. Casting all your care upon him. Why? Because he cares for you. What's the point? The yoke that's under consideration here is a first sign, a first inkling of responsibility. But it is not responsibility in the sense that it is totally mine, and I have to face all the burdens of life, the vicissitudes of life, and the consequences of sin myself. No, Christ says, I am in this with you. So he is yoked with us. And so rather than being some sort of imposition by a victor over those whom he vanquishes, Jesus is saying, I will work together with you in order to accomplish this rest that we're talking about. So drop down to the last point on the second page there, that it symbolizes obedience and submission. Now I want you to think about this. Everything that's talked about in this context from the standpoint of responsibility, and this is the first of two successive emphases upon responsibility, it's all voluntary. If I do something wrong and I'm going to be punished for it, I'm going to have to pay a fine or some sort of consequence, some probation, or maybe even do some jail time. All those things are imposed upon me by a victor of sorts, and I'm the one that's vanquished. But in this context, the yoke that we bear is done willingly. We opt for the yoke. It's our decision. It's our desire, in the context of being yoked in the work that Jesus has in mind, to do so with a humble, willing, loving spirit. Now, does anybody really love their job? Nobody wants to volunteer that they love their job. I love what I do. You might say, well, that's not fair, you're a preacher. Well, I know some preachers don't love being preachers. Seriously. But I love doing what I do. And I don't consider what I do to be work. And you might say, well, we know that, preachers don't work. That's not what I'm saying. I can study for hours and hours and hours. I can travel all over the place. And I like to do what I'm doing. It's a labor, but it's a labor of love. And so the time and the things that I do in the context of doing the work, I do them because I want to do them. My kids will say, Dad, we see you're traveling all over the country again. I said, I only do what I want to do. Nobody imposes this upon me. I've traveled 80 plus thousand miles in the course of the last 2 years promoting international gospel hour, all because I want to do so. Nobody said, you have to travel X number of miles. It's something I want to do. It's something that I enjoy doing, meeting people and talking about the prospect of enhancing means by which we can spread the gospel of Christ. Now imagine coming to Christ and Christ giving you this yoke. And it's a shared yoke with not only other brothers and sisters in Christ, but it's a shared yoke in context of what God wants us to do through Christ. And it's something that we choose to do, not something that's forced upon us. Now, this would have meant everything to those Jews who heard this message, because the law was an imposition upon them that they did not choose to have apply to them. And the consequences of sin are things that God imposed upon them, and they had no say in the matter. But what Christ is asking us to do is to take this upon ourselves willingly. Are we commanded to do so? Yes, if we want to be saved by the Christ. But yet the decision is still one that we make. Notice the second condition, point number 5. The second condition of responsibility, Jesus says, learn from me. Now for some people, learning is really a yoke. I don't know about you, but I like to learn. I like to study. I like learning new things. My dad just turned 95 a couple of weeks ago, June 10th. I had an opportunity to go visit him in the context of visiting another church about the work. And my dad likes to read. My dad likes to learn. He doesn't buy into the idea, well, I'm too old to learn anything. You know that adage, you can't teach an old dog new tricks and that sort of thing. Well, I'm getting to be an older dog, but I still like to learn. Jesus says in the context of not only this but other passages that there's a benefit to learning. John chapter 6. God says in verse 44 through the words of the Christ that God's going to draw all people unto himself, because when they are taught and when they learn of me, they're going to be drawn to me. And Jesus alludes to a passage in Isaiah chapter 54 and verse 13 when it talks about blessings attributed to future Israel. Well, what kind of blessings are we talking about that are going to be attributed to future Israel? Well, right now you're poor and your cities are decimated, but one day you're going to be rich, spiritually speaking, and your cities are going to flourish. And so he talks about all these things in which they're suffering physically because of their sins, but God's going to restore them. And one of the things it says, an incredible blessing is going to come to your children because they will get to learn who I am and experience righteousness. Really? That learning makes you happy? And it leads you to a righteous state in God's sight? That's exactly what Jesus was alluding to in John 6, 44 and following. Christianity is a taught religion. Years ago, I interviewed for a job. We worked for 25 years in the greater Philadelphia area. And occasionally, I would have to take second jobs in order to support our family, because it was always tough raising support. On one occasion, I went to a job fair, and I got an interview out of that. And this particular company was one of the oldest mutual finance companies in the country at that time, founded in the 1840s, as I recall. Huge, huge company. And this position was for a sales position, as you might imagine. But it started with $50,000 base pay. And this is way, way back, like 25 years ago, when $50,000 was a lot of money. Don't get me wrong, it's still a lot of money, but it was more then. And in the context of this interview, a guy leaned across the table and he looked at me and he said, "Are you teachable?" Never been asked that before. This company was a big company. They didn't need some idiot that they were going to recruit who thought he was smarter than they were, who was going to reinvent the wheel and do business his own way. And I asked this. I said, "Are you asking me, can I bite my tongue and learn company things, you know, according to company ways, so that you're going to pay me $50,000 a year?" And he said, "Yes, that's what I want to know." I said, "I can do that." And so I ask my students when they come to the school of preaching, I look at them, I say, "Are you teachable?" When you lose the ability to be taught, you lose the ability to be God's. Because God always wants teachable people. I love to learn. I love to be taught by somebody who knows something that I don't, and God knows everything that I don't. And so when I read his word, I must look for ways in which I'm saying, "Lord, you're teaching me that I need to adopt this practice or this principle or this attitude in life." And so Jesus says one of the things that we need to do in addition to bearing this yoke, the second condition of responsibility is, can we be taught? It's not enough to be a disciple in the sense of follower, in the sense of just follow after me, the first passage we talked to about Matthew chapter 4. But followers in the sense of disciples are also learners. We learn to follow and we follow to learn, and those things go hand in hand. If you've been a Christian forever and a day, amen, and you stop learning, something's wrong. because there's always more to learn. There's always more to fine-tune. There's always a nuance and a principle that you haven't practiced and mastered yet. I don't know how many times I've talked to other people and been able to share something and say, I've never seen that before. And they'll look at me and teach me something, I'll think, I've never seen that before. And I've been in the preaching and teaching and studying business for 40 years. Do you think I know everything? No. I know a lot of stuff that I don't know, and I'm willing to learn. Are you teachable? Are you teachable? Do you have a degree of humility and selflessness about you that will enable you to come to Christ on Christ's terms so He can teach you about what it means to be like Him? Notice the promise is repeated. Excuse me, number 6, immediately after that. What is it that they're going to learn? The nature of Christ. Jesus says, I'm gentle and lowly in heart. Now notice, the teacher wants us to adopt and adapt the nature and the character that he has. Have you ever had a teacher that was overly stern and overly regimented and you learned a lot of stuff, but you did learn that you wanted to be like that person? Oh yeah, I've had those teachers. Learned a whole lot, but I don't want to be like you. But Jesus isn't just trying to teach us stuff. The things that he teaches us is intricately tied to who he is. And in the course of learning what he wants us to learn, because we are teachable, there's a natural tendency for us to say, I want to be like that master. This is not a teacher who's just telling me stuff that's good to know, but not telling me I need to be like him. The best teachers, spiritual and otherwise, are worthy of emulating in character, not just in repeating the knowledge that they convey. And Jesus says, I want you to learn who I am. Yes, I'm the teacher. Yes, you have to come to me. But I want you to notice what he says about his heart, gentle and lowly in heart. You know, we talked about this before, that the yoke that we bear is one that we assume. We allow this yoke to be placed upon us. It indicates a level of submission that God wants us to demonstrate. Did Jesus not also demonstrate a submissiveness to the will of the Heavenly Father? Absolutely. One of the most powerful passages, I'm working on a series of 5 lessons on the radio program that I hope to start in the next few weeks, called The Obedience of Christ. And the very first one is going to be taken from John chapter 15, verses 8, 9, and 10, where Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments, just as I love the Father and keep his commandments. Notice what he said. I'm asking you to do what I am in principle already doing. I'm asking you to follow me so that you'll obey abide in my love. But that's exactly what I do towards the Father. The next point, the promise is repeated. Number 7, you will find rest for your souls. And again, I want to repeat, the rest under consideration here is not temporary. It's not partial. It's permanent. It's contrasted with physical rest in the sense that we would look at it. And then the last part of that, number 8 on the last page, the condition, the promise, the nature of Christ is all fit together. The yoke indicates that it's a burden, but it's a responsibility that we assume. And in the context, the word easy is used. Now, the word easy in this sense means it suits us and it fits us well. It's not saying that it's not going to be anything at all to bear it, but it's something that's useful. It's something that we can do. It's something that fits who we are in character. And so when we adopt the nature and the character of Christ, who is meek and lowly and gentle, and we allow him to teach us and we become more like him, Romans chapter 8, verse 29, then ultimately we have the peace that passes understanding that the writer says in Philippians chapter 4, Paul, towards the church at Philippi. And we develop that sense of comfort that transcends anything in this world. Now, I don't know about you, but the more I live in this world, the less I want to stay here forever. This is not a place I want to stay in. This world's a mess. And I don't know that it's going to get any better. God wants us to understand that this world isn't our home. Our citizenship is in heaven. And in order to obtain that, in order to finally reach that perfect place of comfort, we need to do what's brought out in this passage. We need to follow Jesus' invitation to come to him, realizing that the appeal that comes to us is based upon the burden of sin, and that the rest that he's provided for us comes at a cost, bearing his yoke willingly, learning who he is willingly, becoming like him in character and gentleness and lowliness of heart, understanding that the ultimate rest that's provided for us is only going to take place when we become as much like Christ as we possibly can. My purpose in life and your purpose in life is to be less me and you to be less you, and in the process become more like God through Christ. Thanks so much for your time and your attention.